Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to be showing you exactly how I installed my Renogy 3000 watt high frequency split phase inverter charger. If you guys are thinking about purchasing anything from Renogy, make sure to use that discount code MADE2TRAVEL when you go to checkout and you'll receive an extra discount. If you guys are new to the channel, be sure to check out my simple solar guide. I'll link it below and up in the corner. It is perfect for beginners. It has a schematic, it has parts list, it has a ton of information about each component and what it does. I've had a lot of great feedback on the guide. It's helped a lot of people out when they are installing their solar system, so be sure to check it out. I recently came out with a review video and an unboxing video about the product, but I've had this installed for a couple weeks now. It's been performing awesome, and I want to talk a little bit more about two features that this inverter charger has. Number one being high frequency. So the difference between high frequency and low frequency. Low frequency inverters are heavier and they have a higher idle power consumption, but they are better for inductive loads and large surges. High frequency inverters are much lighter, like half the weight. They have a lower power consumption, but the two downsides are they do cost a little bit more and they don't tend to last as long as low frequency inverters. The last inverter charger that we had by Renogy was the 2000 watt one, and that was actually a low frequency inverter charger. It treated us really well, although it was super heavy and it did have a higher idle consumption. So I'm really interested to see how long this one will last. I don't think we'll have any problems because Kaylee and I don't live in our van full time. We don't have this thing operating every day, but we do spend 2 to 3 months at a time. The second thing I wanted to talk about is the split phase feature. So this inverter can actually operate on 120 or 240 volts, which is really nice if you have an air conditioner, if you have a water heater, if you have an induction stovetop. This is gonna be perfect for you because this inverter charger is gonna be able to handle those 240 volt appliances, unlike many other inverter chargers out there that can only handle 120 volts. With that said, the 240 volt outlet is only available when you are connected to a split phase power source. So this could be a generator, it could be a plug-in in a campground, it could also be a connection to your house. One of the other things I've really noticed about the Renogy Rego 3000 watt inverter charger is how quiet it is, and the fact that you can actually silence that beeper. On their old inverter chargers, the fan would kick on every once in a while and it would beep every time you turned it on, and those things were just getting a little irritating. This one, very quiet. I've installed the remote in the same place that I had my old one, although I did have to chisel out a little bit of the wood because this one is a little bit bigger. It's really easy to install. There's just the power button here, and you can see that the inverter's on and on 12 volt power. If it's connected to shore power, that'll be solid green. And then you also have a little light on the right hand side here that is an error light. So if you have any problems or the inverter charger is having issues, that'll light up. And then there's just a power button right here. So really easy to use. You wanna have it installed in a convenient spot for sure. To install this guy, you simply just have to cut out the hole, and then this black piece is kind of like a cover frame, and there's four little screws. You can put one on each corner. It's really easy to install. You shouldn't have any issues. The hardest part is just gonna be cutting out the hole. As you can see, I've completely reconfigured my solar system based on mounting this vertically like it should be installed. You can't mount it horizontally on a vertical surface. They don't recommend it. You can either mount it this way on a vertical surface or flat on the ground. That's really the only way that you can do it. I've made sure that there's lots of clearance around the outside, so it has some area to cool down. I really like the new install. You can see I got my 400 amp hour Rego battery there, and then I have all my fuses here. I've already popped the cover off here. The cover is really easy to come off. It just has two of these finger nuts, or you can use a screwdriver if you wish. First up, let's start with the 12 volt battery connections. I have my positive and negative connections there. That is 4-aught cable going up and to my negative and positive bus bars. My negative bus bar is right here. That's the negative connection. And then the positive bus bar is actually going right here. They are both black cables. I wish I could get red, but I installed this during COVID, so red was actually not available for me, unfortunately. On my positive cable that goes up, you can see I have a fuse installed right here. This is a 400 amp fuse. I'm gonna link all these products that I've used below in the description if you wanna check them out. Next up is gonna be my 120 voltage connection, which is right here. I have my shore power coming in through the wall right there. This is my shore power connection. So I've switched it up. It's just a three prong here. I did have a 30 amp connection, but I was never using that and decided that this would be much easier for me. The wire from this for my shore power basically just runs up behind the taillight there, comes in through that hole. And then this is actually the orange wire. So it comes down and I actually have a fused disconnect here just for a safety precaution. I've never had to replace it or touch the fuses, but I just like to have it, you know, just in case. The wire then comes out of this and down and right into here. This is where the shore power comes in. Let me zoom in there. And then this is where my 120 volt comes out. So you have your positive, you have your neutral, and then you have your ground. That comes out and up and actually goes into a fuse box there. Now, this is something that, again, like my fuse disconnect coming in, that you don't necessarily require. I like to have it, and I'm also able to isolate different circuits. So I will link this below in the description if it's something that you're interested in. I have two circuits, both with 15 amp breakers there. Next up is gonna be the ground connection, which is kind of hard to see, and they honestly put it in a really weird spot. The ground screw is actually like right here on the outside. You can see the top of the ground screw right there in between the wiring. And what I've done for grounding this is I've simply just grounded it to my negative bus bar, which is grounded to the van. It comes up and attaches right here. That is my ground for the controller. You always want to make sure that these are grounded properly. There are multiple grounds on the inverter charger. There is a neutral ground back here, but I have not grounded this because that is supposed to go out to a grounding rod. If you have a more permanent setup, that is where you'd want to connect your ground rod to. Next up on these connections, right here, I have my remote wire. This continues down and goes to the remote. This connection right here is the battery voltage sensor. Super easy to wire up. All you have to do is connect the negative to your negative bus bar and the positive to your positive bus bar. This is the battery temperature sensor. So I just have mine hanging out right here beside the battery. You can see the lights here. So the inverter is on, the battery is flashing, which means I'm on battery power right now. And then there's also an AC in light. Underneath that is the buzzer. You can turn it on or off. And then frequency. In Canada, we typically use 60 hertz. So I have mine set to 60. On the other side, you can switch it to 50. And then there's a priority switch here. So you can do AC or battery. Underneath that, you have the on off and the remote switch. Mine's set to remote because that's typically what we do. And then right here is the Bluetooth antenna. At the top is the dial for user, where you can put custom settings, lithium, which is what mine's set to because I have a lithium iron phosphate battery. There's also options for gel, flooded, or solid, or AGM. You can also tighten down the wiring using the clamps underneath here, which is a really nice feature. And then there's plenty of holes through here where you can feed more wires. There is also a dread connection if you have a built-in generator that you want to hook up. It comes with this guy, but there's no actual wiring. So I'm guessing I don't have a generator built in, but this will connect to a generator for a start and stop. As far as wiring that goes, I'm not too sure. You'd have to follow the diagrams in the manual. All right, guys, so let's jump into the app. I just turned on my hot water heater. So you can see right away that we are using 1388 watts right now, which isn't even half of what this inverter is capable of. It has a bit of a diagram up here for shore watts, load, battery, and then output priority, grid first. You can turn the output on or off here. And then there's L1 input volts, L2 input volts, input amps, charge watts, output volts, so we're sitting at 120, output amps, 11.55 amps, load watts, 1388 watts. That is for my hot water heater right now. And then output frequency, battery volts, battery amps. We're taking almost 120 amps from the battery right now. And then it also has the temperature there. Up in the right hand corner, we can go to device info. Underneath device info, you have settings. So battery type is set to lithium. You can't change that in the app. You'd have to use the dial on the actual inverter charger. Lithium active enable is on. That is if you have a lithium battery like I do that can go into shelf mode. Power saving mode, so you can flick that on if you want to save some power. There are charge amps, 100. You can actually put this up to 150 amps or as low as 5 amps if you want to charge your batteries really slow. If you want to charge them up really fast, you can do it to 150. I have mine set to 100 right now. Grid input current limit max. So when you're connected to the grid, you can edit this. It goes from 1 amp to 50 amps. I love how many settings are customizable in this. Equalization volts, so that is something that I can't change, along with boost volts, float volts, overvolts, protection. I can't change any of them because I have mine set to lithium right now. If I wanted to change them, you just go back, set that dial to user, and then you'd be able to go in and alter all of these if you want to. I always suggest that people take a look at their battery, because batteries do differ from model to model. Even if they are lithium iron phosphate or gel, they can be a little bit different. So you can customize these depending on what is better for your battery. And then there is also underneath the setting is OTA, which stands for over the air updates. Now I'm going to go ahead and plug this in so we can see what it looks like when it is charging from shore power. Okay guys, so I just plugged into shore power and I'm going to show you how cool this inverter is. Now it shows that we're getting power from shore, and I have limited the input to 15 amps. It's pulling 14.99, because if I pull over that, my breaker is going to trip. What it is doing right now is balancing between the load and the battery. So right now it is providing power to the load, to the hot water heater, but it is also charging the battery with the leftover power. So right now we're getting about 33 amps into the battery, and then the rest of it is going to the hot water tank. So you can see L1 input volts is 97.5, L2 input volts is 0, because that is where you need to connect to get 220 volt if you want to use that split phase feature. Like I said before, I don't have that installed, so we're seeing no voltage there. If you guys have any questions about installing the Renogy Rego 3000 watt high frequency split phase inverter charger, please let me know in the comments below. Check out all the parts that I have in the description, all the parts that I would recommend using for your install. And again, be sure to use that Made to Travel discount code if you're purchasing anything from Renogy. Thank you guys so much for watching. Like and subscribe if you got some value out of this video. It would really help out the channel, and I'll see you guys in the next one.